Happy Wednesday, everybody. Welcome to another episode of Viall Files. Three times this week already. You think they're sick of us yet?
I don't think so.
I hope not.
January Jones, are you kidding me?
We're pot committed. How are you?
I'm good. How are you?
I'm great. That's been a great week. Had a fun weekend.
I saw you were at the Golden Globes.
Golden Globes was fun.
That's crazy. Is that your first time?
It was my second time. I went last year. I took Demi as my date.
Wait, how do you get invited to the Golden Globes? Asking for a friend.
I've done some work with Dick Clark Productions. They put on the event. They run the red carpet, and so. And I also did a little hosting bit with E! News this year.
Oh, you did?
So it was a little bit of both. But as far as the Golden Globes itself and the ceremony, yeah, I went as a guest as Dick Clark production.
Oh, that's nice.
It was a lot of fun. And basically hung out in the back room. And I mean, like, yeah, it's wild. Like, you walk the carpet. And, you know, I don't get starstruck very easily, but you see a lot of
who was the coolest?
Harvey Keitel. From Reservoir Dogs.
That's such a guy answer.
He's a legend, right? I mean,
I don't even know who that is.
It's the men who, like, you know, I don't know how you are. Like, if women, you get more starstruck with women than men. Captain America,
yeah,
was there. I was trying to get Demi to hit on him. He was with his brother.
Really?
And, you know, just kind of, he looks just as nice in person. Just like he has a calming energy to him. He was like 5 feet away, talking to his brother, hanging out, looking super friendly.
Yeah.
Demi is like, that's Chris Evans. I'm like, oh, say hi. He's with his brother. If a guy brings his brother, he couldn't be more single.
You think?
What do you mean, I think? He might be hanging out with women, he might be talking to someone, but he's definitely not committed to anyone. And
you don't think maybe his brother just really wanted to go?
He's been Captain America for a while now. You know what I'm saying? This is not like, hey, I just made
my
it big.
First
my first big break, and I'm gonna bring my brother as a So anyways, she chickened out.
She did.
Yeah, she didn't say
that. Do you think she had a good time though?
She had a great time. And then Kate McKinnon from SNL. Her and her sister came up. Turns out big Bachelor fans.
Wait, really?
She was very sweet. Like the nicest person in the world. So that was just kind of fun to hang out and had a really good time.
That's awesome.
Yeah. And when I was done, I used my Hydrate Spark.
Oh, did
was,
you?
I needed to hydrate after a long day of a little bit of hosting and a lot of entertaining myself.
We have our Hydrate Spark 3 bottles here.
It's amazing because I never really know how much water to drink or when I should drink.
Exactly.
And I personally find drinking enough water to be one of the most mentally and physical taxing experiences of my life.
I don't know why, but yes, you've said that before, so I believe
it truly is. I guarantee you people who are listening can relate.
So Nick and I, we both downloaded the Hydrate Spark app to our phone. Really easy. You sync it up. Yeah, we're going to make our bottles glow. This is the best part. They glow when you need to drink more water. Look! Ah, it's so cool.
Glow. Oh, there it is.
Yours glows green.
Mine
you can see. I have the coral sun, color.
The sun's kind of blocking it.
Yeah.
Anyways, if you are someone who does forget to drink enough water, and drink enough water is one of the simplest, I know it's not simple for me, in terms of just being healthier.
Yeah.
It's better for your skin. It's better for your internal organs. It's something that should be so easy and it's so healthy to do, but yet we never do enough of. But Hydrate Spark, can't talk today, makes it easier.
Yeah, and it's like kind of a fun and fashionable way to do it also. Yeah. You're not carrying around like a gallon jug all day.
I know. Trust me, you are going to love the Hydrate Spark 3 Smart Water Bottle 2. And right now, you can get 20% off your first order, but only if you use our discount code VIALL at checkout. It's spelled with an I, so that's Hydrate Spark.com, and use the discount code VIALL at checkout for our special offer. I also used my OPENFIT over the holidays.
You used it over the holidays when you were home?
When I was home, you know?
In Wisconsin.
I went to the gym a couple times, but a couple times, like during Christmas, everything kind of shuts down.
Totally.
Busted out the OPENFIT.
Nice.
Did some yoga with mom.
Aw.
You know, and we checked it out.
Does your mom do yoga?
My mom does yoga every morning.
I believe it. Yeah. She looks good. Oh, every morning?
She does yoga every morning.
Oh, my God.
So I did a little yoga with mom, and we checked out OpenFit, took some classes over the holidays. I mean, it couldn't have been more convenient, and that's what I love about it. It kind of travels with you because it's on your phone.
Yeah, and you can lose up to 15 pounds in just 30 days. I mean, that's on all of our goals right now.
I just want to be healthier.
Right. You already look good.
Listen, you got to stay committed to anything. Shavings make a pile. We know this. And the only way to make a pile with shavings is to be consistent. And to be consistent, you need things like OpenFit to help you do that.
Yeah.
OpenFit has changed the way I work out, as you just heard. And with my code VIALL, you can join me on a fitness journey personalized just for you. Right now, my listeners get a 14-day free trial membership to OpenFit when you text VIALL to 50-50-50. Try it for free or your money back. It's entirely risk-free, so what do you have to lose besides the weight? You will get full access to OpenFit, all the workouts, and nutrition guide. Totally free for 14 days. Again, just text VIALL to 50-50-50. Great episode today. Gabbie Hanna joins us today. What a talented individual.
Yeah, she's a huge YouTube star.
But she's also a singer, actor, a writer. She's doing it all.
Yeah.
She's been around for a while. She has some great stories and great life lessons.
Yeah.
And anyways, I enjoyed the conversation with her, and I think you will too. So stick around. And as always, thanks for listening. Don't forget to send in your questions to asknick@castmedia.com. That's cast with a K. Give us 5 stars if you want. Thanks for listening to us 3 times this week. We'll see how it goes. Up next, Gabbie Hanna. Gabbie Hanna, how are you?
I'm good. How are you?
I'm great. Thanks for coming on.
I'm very happy to be here.
The first time I knew you existed was at the Streamies last year.
Cool.
And you won. Congratulations, by the way. And you won for storytelling.
Mm-hmm.
And then I started, you know, looking you up, and I like a good storyteller, and you were kind of always on my radar, so to speak, from that point on. So I appreciate you finally having an opportunity to come and, you know, get to know you a little bit more. So for those of you who don't know you, share with people a little bit about all the things you are doing, because it is quite a lot. I mean, it's
messy.
Is it messy?
Yes, it's too many things sometimes, I think. But I started off doing internet stuff like Vine and YouTube. Now my focus is I write poetry books, I do music, and I just started a podcast. So I just kind of
congratulations, by the way.
Thank you. Congratulations to you on this podcast.
Oh, thank you. Everyone's just congratulating. When you won for storytelling last year, that was like on your YouTube channel. What about that did you? I only asked because storytelling is so. It's a lost art these days. I love
it.
You don't?
No, I do.
I really do. And really good storytelling is interesting. A podcast is a version of storytelling.
What do you mean it's a lost art?
You don't think so?
Good stories? I feel like there's more than ever. More with all the digital services, there's more TV shows.
Well, that's why I think it's a lost art in a sense of like good storytelling.
Oh.
Real storytelling. Not just like talking.
Okay.
You know? Hey, guys. You know?
Yeah.
What made you good at, you know, storytelling, and how did you kind of
Did
you win that award? I guess I'm curious.
Dramatic by nature, I think. No, I just the way I came up on the internet was just sharing a lot of my personal life and telling stories. And I always say that everyone's like, how do you live this life? Like, how can so many crazy things happen to you? Because I think I'm making it up. And I'm like, well, I'm not making it up. It all happens. It's just I see life through a lens of stories and other people don't. So like, I did a whole story about this experience I had trying to cancel a gym membership, and the woman gave me a hard time, which is something a million people have experienced.
That's a very relatable, the gym membership cancel project is.
So that's something that's not unique to me, but the way I tell it is a story. A gym membership
cancel. Can you imagine a whole movie about
a horror film?
Right? Or just like the whole, like there's, I'm sure, a bunch of other like B storylines going on, but the general premise is how they can't, you know, like they fall in love along the way. I don't know, there's some drama.
Yeah, and like she has all this stuff that's going on behind the scenes that makes her not want to cancel the gym membership. Yeah.
But they could probably could make a whole movie out of that. Probably. So that was a big episode for you. So
yeah.
That's an example. So you see that, you know, people, as you say, everyone goes through a lot of people have been through the gym membership cancellation,
yeah.
but you romanticize it.
I get very worked up over it and I want to talk about it. So like the type of story where you'd go home and tell like your girlfriend or your best friend, like, dude, I tried to cancel this membership today and it was so fucking annoying. I just did that to a camera.
So you, when you say you get worked up, you would describe yourself as an emotional person.
Clearly.
I don't know you that well.
You've only known me for 10 minutes, and I feel like you can tell I'm
so
emotional.
You are a very emotional person.
Yes.
And do you like that you're an emotional person?
I do, now that I know how to hone it and put it where it belongs.
Okay.
I used to be a very emotionally reactive person. So like in relationships with like either friends, family, men, whatever it would be, I felt like I needed to react right away. But now I'm 28 years old and know how to like reel it in and communicate effectively.
What do you mean by you feel like you needed to react? Did you felt like you had the ability to control it and you needed to, or it just, that's just what happened. And then you would kind of take a step back and go, okay, I kind of reacted.
I just am somebody who likes to resolve things right away, or at least I used to be.
Okay.
So like if I was having an issue with, say, a boyfriend, mm-hmm. I would be like, okay, well, that really hurt my feelings. I want to talk about this right now. Like, why can't we fix this right now? And then the guy would be like, because I just like need a minute to think. And I'm like, well, what do you mean? Like, can't we think about it right now? So it caused a lot of chaos.
Well, I'm not...
Nick's like
that. I like to fix things right now for sure, but I'm sensitive, but I'm not emotional, especially in relationships with fights. I'm more the, all right, let's talk about it.
Very rare in a man.
It's, well, you think so?
I think so.
I find my significant others have found it annoying because I have,
really?
I've dated highly emotional women. Can I say that? I don't know.
Yeah. No, you can. I don't think emotional is a negative trait.
I don't think so either, but sometimes I just don't really know.
Yeah. I think it's when you learn how to like hone your emotions. So now instead of reacting right away, I take a step back. I like kind of put a pin in it and I say, let's talk about this in a minute. But then I can also put it into like music or writing or art. So it's better to have an outlet, I find.
When you were more emotionally triggered at first, uh-huh. were you ever mean?
I don't know if mean is the word. Like, I never try to hurt people to hurt people, but probably in the process, people get hurt. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
But it's not like I'm somebody who, if you hurt my feelings, I'm going to try to say something vile to you to hurt
yeah,
you.
Yeah, not manipulative, not manipulatively, but more... Yeah, like, because sometimes we accidentally hurt
yeah.
our partners because we are feeling, we feel hurt. And yeah. then, like, that reaction is to, it's not the intention to hurt them, but it's a defense mechanism.
I would say when I was younger, for sure, but you and just got to go to a lot of therapy.
So through your art and through the things that you're doing, was it like an awareness that you had?
You know, I think it was more so therapy.
You went to therapy. Okay.
Oh, yeah.
You're big into mental health.
For sure. I think that therapy is so important for everybody, regardless of if you... I think, honestly, everybody should have to go to therapy, if you feel like you're mentally sound, because there's just things that you can figure out about yourself that you can't figure out in a day-to-day.
Nick's never been.
Not true. I mean, on The Bachelor, you have to...
Doesn't count.
I will say she did say to me that some people aren't good with therapy, and I think you'll get a kick out of this, Rochelle. And she didn't say I wouldn't be good with it, but she suggested I might not be because I'm an overthinker, and sometimes I would almost like, I mean, I enjoy talking to her, right? Yeah. In a sense that like I could just keep talking and like rethinking it.
What's wrong with that?
Because you never get to a place where you, like...
You need a better therapist.
You never get to a conclusion. You just, like, overanalyze and overanalyze and overanalyze and go back for more.
But I think that's kind of the point of therapy, is especially if you're an overthinker, it means that you have so many thoughts going in your head at once and you're looking at so many different situations and how they could play out. But if you're talking to the right therapist who can kind of pull you back and say, well, why do you feel that way? What brought you to that? What situation, blah, 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 blah. And then you can pull back all of the layers and the directions that your brain are going and then go to the one that actually matters, is what I found.
I'm a big supporter and advocate of
yeah.
I think
I feel like you should do meditation just to distance yourself from that. Totally. Have you tried?
Overthinkers cannot meditate.
Oh, really?
I don't think so. I've tried.
I've struggled.
You tried meditation?
Yeah. I don't know if I've ever made it a real attempt. I've done yoga a few times, like the end of class, you yeah. know, things like that. A couple times I've been in group settings where they brought in like a hypnotist. And I've tried, like, I just can't get to a place where my mind's never not just clicking.
Are you a very anxious person?
Yeah. Yeah.
And you never wanted to try therapy?
I'm not that I haven't wanted to try it. I just...
Don't think it's for you.
Vanessa and I, my last relationship, we did couples therapy at the end of our relationship. I enjoyed that. Like, I've never like felt like I was like in a dark place or I felt like I needed to like on my own. Well, that's not true. I probably felt like I needed to. I just haven't done it.
I was gonna say, wait.
I haven't actually done it. But I did enjoy the couples therapy. I did.
You have to be ready to go or it's not going to help you. Like you can't have somebody force you to go to therapy and then it really do much for you, because if you're not in the mental place to be open to the experience, then the whole time you're going to be sitting there saying, this isn't for me.
How old were you when you first went?
23 or 24, maybe, I think.
What was the event or the experience that made you go, you know what, I'm just going to go talk to somebody?
Well, my anxiety was so bad to the point where I was like afraid to sleep at night because I was imagining people like breaking into, well, my apartment was also very not safe, but there was just so much anxiety and anxious thoughts at all times. And then I felt like I was getting so angry all the time, and I don't like being an angry person, and I didn't want to feel that anger. And then I was in a scandal. That was 5 years ago, every year, November. And I was being accused of like stealing jokes, and then like all of Reddit was attacking me, calling me a joke thief. And then with that comes you're fat, you're ugly, like just terrible things coming at me all the time. So I was just like, okay, I'm angry, I'm depressed, my world is collapsing around me, I'm very anxious, I should go to therapy.
Okay.
Yeah.
Steal it. You know, Rochelle and I were talking about something similar last night, and I don't know I'm not familiar with the story of you being accused of being a joke thief, but Rochelle and I were talking about people, you know, a lot of, on the internet, you see a lot of quotes, you know, a lot of,
yes.
And I do this kind of questions with Nick, and I have these sayings, and I just kind of come up with them. And sometimes I get credit for like, oh, that was really original, that was really neat. But I you hear about people being accused of like stealing quotes or stealing jokes. And I was just like, the truth is, the things I'm saying can't be that original. And I'm pretty sure out there someone's probably said it in a different way, slightly different. You might have like put like a different word in there. Yeah. But like, we're kind of at that point where
everything's been said.
Any real thought that original.
Yeah.
And, you know, jokes, like it's probably been said or documented in a slightly different way. So if you tell a joke and you were determined, which I'm sure maybe some people on the internet might be, to prove you wrong or prove that you did something.
Yeah.
Probably
well,
that
in that situation, it was, and I actually did learn a lot from it, because the main joke that I was accused of stealing, I immediately was like, oh my God, I've heard that before. But it was one of those instances of I heard it because I had a stand up on Pandora playing on shuffle at all times.
Yes.
So then when I was doing a YouTube video, I just like said something that had been said. And then when I saw it, I was like, oh my God, like, yeah, for sure. Totally have heard that, like whatever, admitted it. But then they went through my years of tweets and years of YouTube videos and hundreds of hours of footage to put like six examples that were so far-fetched. Like Bo Burnham tweeted something in 2012, and then in 2015, I tweeted something similar. Whoa. Or like Mitch Hedberg made a joke 20 years ago, and then like a couple years ago, I said something similar. So when you put them back to back to back to back to back, yeah, I look like a joke thief. But years later, I found out the kid who did the video was a guy who I went to junior high with, who
oh
like, yeah. And like after that had been like tweeting at me being like, hey, when are you coming home? Like There was some type of weird vendetta behind it.
Yeah, I'm like, who has time to go through every one of your tweets?
They really dug. But at the end of the day, I honestly did learn so much from that. I became a better writer because of it. I was way more careful with my content, and I like check and double check and triple check to make sure that it's an original thought. So it made me better.
Even if you're just talking to the camera, like that's technically stealing.
Yeah, I was curious about that. If you are, if you tweet something or go on camera and just, like you said, you hear, you've heard a joke, you know, you watch some comedy show and then you're telling a story and you kind of loosely repeat the joke, do you have to like credit them? Even if in that moment you're not even thinking about that. Like we've all done that. We've all like referenced indirectly.
Yeah.
I can't think of anything on the top of my head, but like the type of joke that, you know, we hear.
I think it kind of depends what lens people are looking at you through. So when I was coming up on Vine and YouTube, people were labeling me as like a wannabe comedian, which is something I'd never label myself as a comedian because
I mean, I'm a wannabe comedian.
Well, I just am not and was not. So when they're looking at these like young kids who are gaining all these followers and, you know, making money off of doing this, there's a type of microscope they're looking at you, because a lot of people think that people who come up on the internet are undeserving. So it's basically like, oh, look at this girl making this money stealing jokes from the greats. But also, if I was stealing jokes, you think I'm gonna steal a joke from Louis C. fucking K? You know what I mean? Like,
as if I'm not gonna get caught.
Like, it obviously wasn't a conscious effort, because if I was gonna steal a joke, it'd be from a very unpopular source that would be hard to track. I'm not gonna steal one of the most famous jokes of all time.
Yeah,
I've definitely referenced his miracle flight before.
Oh, that's so funny, dude. So have I, for sure.
What's that?
He had a great bit about, you know, how we complain about things.
I think about that every time I'm on a plane, where the guy is,
you
like,
know, we're on a plane, we're always bitching. Right. He's like, do you not realize what you're doing in this moment?
You're on a chair in the sky.
Yeah. I mean, it's
a good joke.
It's a great joke. It's really funny in the way he delivers it. But I've definitely like joked about that.
Right.
And I'm sure I probably referenced it, but I haven't always been like, oh, well, don't. I guess I wouldn't go on the internet and tell that joke.
And I wouldn't either. I just like, I was doing something about Thanksgiving or something and like talked about Columbus and then did his Columbus bit where I was like, hey, like they're not Indians because this was never India, but why do we still call them Indians? Was the gist of it.
That's a common thought.
It's a common thought, but the way I delivered it was pretty much how he delivered it.
Okay.
Yeah.
Luminous air.
It's not, I mean, these airbrush things.
Yes,
it's amazing.
It's airbrush foundation.
I'll be honest. I've had it done to me in a very professional atmosphere.
Exactly. Normally, you only get a professional.
Now you can do it in your home.
Yeah. Now you can do it in your home. Usually, it's like only if you're getting ready for a wedding, or if you're Nick, if you're getting ready for the red carpet. But I have it. It's so easy. It's really small and portable, and it's 100% makeup tone matching guarantee.
Ooh.
Yeah. So you take. You answer all these questions online, you send them a photo, you tell them what you normally wear, and then they help you match your shade. And also, if it doesn't match, you get a 30-day money-back guarantee. But it's like, I feel like I look like 100 times better when I use it. Well,
I think you always look nice for sure.
Oh, thank you.
The little bit I know about makeup, you want an even application.
Exactly.
And I feel like the airbrush makes you do that, so now you can be a professional. Right in the comfort of your home.
Totally. And it's 4-in-1, which means you don't have to put concealer, you don't have to put primer or corrector. It's all of that in one.
Oof. Well, Luminous Air has a limited time offer for you right now. Go to trysilk.com/VIALL to get 60% off your Luminous Silk 4-in-1 airbrush system. That's amazing. 60% off. That's trysilk.com/VIALL. Get smoother, fuller, and more natural looking foundation coverage. Visit trysilk.com/VIALL today. Well, ShipStation, it saved my life through the holidays with Natural Habits.
Did you get a lot of orders in?
It was a great holiday season. Good. Thanks so much for everyone who supports Natural Habits. And like I said, if you are a small business owner, if you're doing any type of shipping and any type of quantity, ShipStation, hard to say, easy to use. It's fantastic. Again, you can ship with USPS, UPS, FedEx, You can track your orders. You get a lot of metrics and reports on your shipping.
It's amazing.
It makes it a lot easier. Any type of customer service issues, it helps resolve those faster.
Yeah. So even if you have like a small Etsy shop,
yeah,
or you sell on Amazon, like anything.
It's really fantastic. So I can't recommend it enough. It's you try it for free, risk-free. You don't even have to put a credit card down.
Yeah.
60-day trial. It's amazing.
Nick really uses
I can't recommend
this.
It enough. Yeah. So get this year off to a great start with ShipStation.com. Just use my code VIALL to get a 60-day free trial. That's 2 months free of no hassle, stress-free shipping. Just visit ShipStation.com, click on the microphone on the top of the page, and type in VIALL. That's ShipStation.com. Enter code VIALL. ShipStation. Make ship happen. So you are, you know, you got your start on Vine. You're heavily involved in YouTube. You're heavily involved in the internet, as you've kind of, we've loosely talked about, like you kind of put yourself out there, potentially open for criticism.
Yeah.
And we kind of live in this world, whether you are an influencer, you have a following, or you're just, you know, Joe from Nebraska or Pam from Arkansas, we have this kind of overshare culture where like even the average person feels the need to kind of put their life on display.
And yeah.
How do you feel about, I mean, you've really put your life out there. And I think that's what a lot of influencers have done. And sometimes they do get criticized for it, fairly or unfairly. What have you learned from that? Or what's your thought process on that? And do you think there's benefits from it? And do you think you have things you have to like deal with or negatives that come from being a part of that world?
If I could redo everything the way I did it, I think that I would share less, because when you put yourself so far out there, like it's, you almost lose touch with how many people are actually watching, if that makes sense. Because like I see a number on a screen and it's like this many million or whatever it is. And that's a number. And I know it's good because statistically people say if you have this many views, blah, 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 blah. But then you have the realization of, oh, that many million people are criticizing my life and deciding on my life. And then you also just put yourself up for, like when you think about a traditional celebrity, like, Angelina Jolie, like nobody's really criticizing her personal life that much. Like they criticize maybe her.
Are you kidding?
You think?
I don't know.
Was that the worst example? Young.
The Jennifer Aniston saga.
That is true. That is true.
I think it was just. I think it was different. Before social media really took off. I mean,
like Emma Stone, I'm thinking about her. She's not on Instagram. No one really, she's getting married. No one even knows.
That's a better example.
Yeah.
It's like somebody like Emma Stone who just like, you love her work. You love her acting. You love her because she is like talented.
Yeah.
People find me because they know my personal story and they're invested in my personal story. So then that leaves your personal story up for criticism. People judge you for your character and not for your work. And then it's, it leaves you open to a lot of, what's the word I'm looking for?
Leaves you
open. Just like speculation, I guess. Speculation. Like people speculate on your life and they feel that they know you personally because of what you've put out, but they only know a portion.
There is that, yeah. I mean, I guess an Angelina Jolie or an Emma Stone or a Brad Pitt, back, like the celebrity back in the day, was there was a level of mystery. You know, it was more in vogue to not do as many interviews or kind of have keep a distance. That like that was the old like in old Hollywood, like the playbook of really kind of keeping yourself at a distance in this kind of mystery of the celebrity. And now it's different. Even now, like your A-listers are, they have social accounts. It's a different playbook, so to speak. But to that point, there is that stress level of people feeling like they know you and like living up to those expectations. How much of that do you think changed how you lived your personal life on a day-to-day basis? Of like, there was ever a point where you felt like I'm doing what Gabbie wants to do, or I'm doing what I think my followers or my listeners or my fans want me to do?
It's changed a lot within the last year, I would say, where I used to really base my life around the internet, because the internet is not only my bread and butter, but it's also my life, because I've made my life into my career. So it was this thing where I was always even when I was off, I was working because I'm always keeping an eye out for, you know, content, or I should be posting, or if an exciting thing was happening, it was like, oh, I should film this so I can talk about it later. And it was this really kind of sick, twisted world of like the Truman Show where I never was actually living.
Yeah. I mean, I truly can't understand, because, you know, I have a following, and to a little point, to a little bit, I do that, but I can't keep up. I get anxiety. It's just like, I don't want to do this. Yeah. And when I do that, I feel like I'm not being present in the moment. And I have a hard enough time being present in general.
Yeah.
I couldn't imagine feeling the pressure of constantly putting out the content that kind of necessitates a very popular YouTube page.
And I did pull back.
The anxiety that comes with that.
I had to stop. I think that the biggest thing, the catalyst that made me stop was, I don't know if you guys saw, but I was a meme. I fulfilled my lifelong dream of being a meme. No, don't. Oh, okay. Do not do it.
Wow.
You can't talk about it. We're totally going to look it up.
You can look it up later. Just don't get in front of me. Okay. Basically, I did a Genius interview that was for my song Monster. And I have a scream note in it where it's just like a very high, like, belty note.
Yeah.
And everybody, when I put out the song, was like, this is cool, but this song, that clearly isn't her singing that note. She can't sing that note, like whatever. Oh. So when I did the Genius interview, I was like, if I do this falsetto or don't sing it full, people are going to say that I can't do it. So when I did it, I asked the guys, I was like, let me know if I'm peaking the audio. Let me know if it's too loud, whatever. Never said it was too loud. Didn't say I was peaking. But then when they cut the interview together, they cut the mics between the camera mic and the boom mic. So like I'm singing in the boom mic. And then when I do the high note, they cut it to the camera mic because I peaked the boom.
Oh.
So they did this like weird cut in the middle of the audio that made it sound very silly.
Yes.
But then that was just the meme. And it started as like,
so I was mocking you.
They were making fun of me, but they would like replace the high note with like a goat screaming or like a phone alarm. So it was funny. Exactly. Yeah. But then from that, because I was like, I became viral and clickable. Now that's when people are coming in saying I'm a scam artist. I'm bullying my fans just because my face was now garnering clicks. So that time was like really painful, and people were judging my character and saying that things that just like simply weren't true about me. And you can't really defend yourself because once people decide that you're manipulative or a scam artist, like no matter what you say, it's just a part of manipulation and a part of scamming. So I just had to like kind of back off, couldn't look at the YouTube, couldn't open the internet, couldn't look at Twitter, couldn't look at Instagram. And through that, found myself again because I was forced to detach from the internet. And then I started focusing more on like my music and my art. And now I live my life pretty much offline, except I post my weekly videos, which is just work. But I'm not like filming my every move, showing my every moment. You know what I mean?
Yeah. And that's impressive. It must be hard to manage that.
Whatever. You know what I mean?
I don't know.
It used to be, but like, you know, it happens so often that it's just like, ugh, who cares at this point?
But you just don't respond. You said you tried to respond and then everyone...
I've responded in the past, but like no matter how sincere or genuine you are, once people decide, like I said, you're manipulative or you're calculated, like, okay, you can't cry because you're playing the victim if you're sad. You can't show that you're sad because you're trying to garner sympathy points. If you're defensive and try to defend yourself, you're defending yourself because you did something wrong. And if you didn't do anything wrong, why are you so defensive?
On the internet, you mean?
Yeah. No, if you're like stoic and you're just trying to be flat and matter of fact, you're a sociopath.
Yeah.
So there's no way to respond where people aren't going to pick you apart. Like there's videos where people are saying, look at her posture. Like she's hunching and that means that she's, you know, enclosed. And like, look at her eyes. Did you notice she looked to the left? That means she's lying. Look at her hand. She's trying to get you to believe her. Did you notice when she said this that she leaned forward? That means she's trying to say like, come here and listen. It's like insane the way people pick apart everything.
That is, I mean, I've always said, I mean, like to not at the, like the YouTube level of kind of documenting your life, but a lot of my peers, you know, the internet will say something and it's hard not to want to reply or respond.
Yeah.
And I'm certainly have done it. I try not to because I generally will say like the only right response to the internet is no response.
Exactly.
At all.
Well, you know, can't Justin win. Timberlake released that thing on Instagram.
Yes.
Because there was a video where he was holding hands.
Yeah, I saw that.
But I would never have seen the video if he hadn't posted that thing because that's what I saw.
I think I saw things about it.
You saw things
about it, but you're right. He brought more awareness to it by putting it out there. But
yeah.
It looked good. I mean, for those of you who don't know, like a couple of weeks ago, Justin Timberlake was seen holding hands with his co-star of a movie he's filming. Certainly led to a lot of speculation. And then he put out this very thoughtful press release kind of acknowledging that it's not what it seemed, but certainly wasn't okay.
Yeah.
But then all the comments on that were like, really? I was looking on his
Instagram. Oh, you did? Yeah.
Mean.
Yeah.
So it's like, Was it good he said something?
That situation's hard.
It's a no-win situation.
I think that personal situations should be left personal and private, and I don't think anything should be made public that was between two people.
Right.
However, that moment was captured publicly, so that's kind of a gray area. Well, I'm like, well, this was public in the outside. First place, so is it something that you can't address publicly? But as far as like, if she had found out that he was cheating one-on-one, do I think she should have brought that public? I don't really know. I just think that there's this boundary that's crossed when you're in the public eye where people do feel like they're entitled to every explanation and every chunk of your life when that's not how normal people work. Like if you were to cheat on your partner, are you supposed to go into his place of work and apologize to everybody for cheating? God. Do you know what I
you're
mean?
Right.
Like there's just like this barrier that's been crossed where I don't understand why you're entitled to so much of our personal.
But I do think, I think it is relative, and we've talked about this before. I don't think it matters if you have 4 million followers, if you have 500. Mm-hmm. You know, when I go home to my Wisconsin, you know, my friends got married a couple years ago, and there was wedding drama, mm-hmm. right? And on Facebook, there was this whole like back and forth and people talking and writing paragraphs, and it was all over their like friend group on Facebook. And like, that's, I feel like where people, whether you're an influencer or not, are starting to go and kind of put it out there and like live this almost, I don't want to say influencer life, but they are, you know, and it's always like sometimes these cryptic ones. Hey guys, you know, I just want to say for all the real friends out there, you know, it's always like this
subtweets.
Yeah. Like these, yeah. these cryptic things. And and again, this is a group of 12 friends. Everyone fucking knows what we're talking about, but they'll put it all over their Instagram and all over their Facebook. And we all overshare now.
We would look at that. And I remember we would see people doing like family drama and friend drama on Facebook. And we would all be like, hey, that's like kind of trashy.
Yeah.
Like don't like keep it to yourself. Why are you posting about like your baby's father
right.
on Instagram, on Facebook? Why are you talking about your best friend from high school so negatively on Facebook? Keep it to yourself. But now we're, like you said, approaching this realm of everybody does it, and I still don't like it. I think that you should respect people's space.
So have you learned on your, it sounds like you have, but your own content you put out there, do you feel like you've made mistakes with oversharing where you look back and be, you know, I like a responsibility out there to be kind of a role model for your fans and people go out there of saying, you know, and I have to put the pause button on here because maybe that's an overshare.
Yes, my line with oversharing, because I've kind of crossed the line with my own personal life mm-hmm. where the only thing I won't really overshare about anymore is my mental health, because I've learned that that is the one thing that I am not willing to have up for speculation anymore, where I would like open up about like my depression or like PTSD and then people are just like, you're faking, and I can't handle that. But my hard line with oversharing is if it involves somebody else. So
sure.
I would rather no, even if somebody's attacking me and coming for me, like I'm not going to respond to that and like drag somebody else because they did it to me, because then you're no better than that person. So if it involves someone else, it will drag their family into it, whatever it is, keep it to yourself. I'd rather like take a few punches and, you know, take hits than hit back.
You posted something, Nick, I thought was interesting on your Instagram. Some girl had said it was like her 1 year anniversary you, and then you reposted it.
Yeah.
You covered her face.
I covered her identity.
Her 1 year anniversary of wedding you?
It was a fan who took a photo with me like a year ago. And, you know, like Instagram or Facebook does this like 1 year anniversary moments of your life. And it must have come up on her phone. It was a picture of with me. And she says, happy anniversary. She tagged me. And it was like something like, great to meet you, you big douchebag, or something like that.
Yeah.
Okay.
And I, you know, you can like add, share to your story if you get tagged. Yeah. So,
wait, she tagged you in that?
How else would I have found it?
That's so mean.
Wait, she was being mean?
Yeah, she was being mean, and then he reposted
it. Oh, so she meant it when she said you're a douchebag.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Well, why did she take a picture with you if you're a douchebag?
Who knows? How
were you a douchebag to her in person?
I don't think so. But I mean, I have at times, you know, I can be aloof or whatever. You know how sometimes people come up to you and like, oh my God, can I take a picture? And you're sometimes caught off guard and you're not like in that moment.
Yeah.
Like, oh, I don't want to annoy you. And then you're like, okay. And you never really know. I don't think so, but you know, I'm sure, you know,
To your defense, I think people don't often recognize the nature of a parasocial relationship where they feel like they know you. And when they come up to you, they're excited because they know you and they're a fan of you. But to you, they are a stranger. So you can't 100% of your time be like, you know, you're out at a bar and you're like just like kind of drunk with your friends and some girl walks up to you. Like, are you now entitled or like obligated to be like, oh my God, I'm so excited to see you as well?
I'm actually reading this new book by Malcolm Gladwell called Talking to Strangers. It's fascinating about how we interpret other people's reactions. But anyways, so I reshared it and I covered her identity. You know, I wasn't trying to get her.
But you still gave it energy.
I did give it energy. And you could debate whether that was, and I actually thought about that in the moment. I mean, I had a caption, my thought was to kind of give people perspective, and it was a snarky little comment said, you know, sometimes people will get, you know, it'll affect you. And it, like, I'll admit, I saw it. I was like, you think to yourself, was I a dick? Oh man, I hope that sucks. I took a picture of someone at the meantime, you know, and you kind of feel like maybe they hated you from the beginning and they took a picture just to like use it to troll you. Who knows, right? But I'll admit it, like it got in my head for a moment. And then I said something like, just remember, no matter what you do, some people can't get enough hugs. Like in the sense of like, you don't really.
Petty.
Okay, that's a lot.
But like, who, like this person decided to put on her internet and
it's
like,
hard not to respond.
And but I mean that, like, who knows if she got it, like, sometimes you don't really know what other people are going through, why they react, why she felt the need to put it out there. I didn't meet her expectations, whatever that was, right? Like, whether I actually was a douchebag or a dick, or I simply just didn't meet her expectations. And she decided to put it out there, and then I decided to react. And it was more, it was kind of petty and snarky. But at the same time, maybe I don't know what she's going through. And sometimes, and the younger me might have spent, maybe not from an internet situation, but if I felt like I did something that I didn't understand how I did that, it would have, like, I'll spend a whole day thinking about it and ruminating about it. Yeah. And then I've gotten to the point in my life where I've realized I don't know what's going on in their life. I don't know what's happened to them, if they had a good day or a bad day or a good year or a bad year. So maybe they just need a hug and I'm going to stop worrying about it.
What was the fallout of that post? Did anything happen?
I don't know. I mean, I blocked her identity. It's not like no one knew. I did like blocked her face and I blocked her Instagram.
If you hadn't, that would have been bad.
Yeah, for
sure. Some people don't. Block.
Yeah, that was my mistake where I honestly did something pretty similar. This is where my whole I bully fans things comes. But this is just one of the situations of there's like a very small portion of the story that was given. And I never responded to it because I was just like, what's the point? Because people already decided you're a certain way. But this was when I was like really struggling with my eating disorder because I was like shooting a music video and I'd like starved myself for 2 weeks. And this girl was commenting all this stuff about how I put out a negative body. Like I also talk about like body positivity and health, and like I do a lot of like training and fitness stuff, so I'm really into promoting a healthy body image. So at this certain time I was struggling by myself as well, but not talking about it, and she was commenting on these pictures saying how I am promoting anorexia and how I pretend to promote body image, but like it's clear from how flat my ass is that I was like starving myself, and just like terrible comments. So then my fans are in the comments responding to her being like, yo, like back off. So then she's messaging, commenting over and over and over saying like, she's so fake, like she pretends to care, but like I'm trying to DM her and she won't even answer. She doesn't care about her fans, whatever. So I'm like, okay, let me DM this girl because she's clearly like hurting, whatever. So then I DM her and I was basically saying like, you know, why do you feel the need to do this? And she said, well, it's just my opinion. Like I'm not hating, it's just my opinion. So then I tried to explain to her, I was like, you're entitled to your opinion and nobody's gonna try to take your freedom of speech away from you, but you can't hide behind the fact that it's your opinion and pretend like it's not hate. You can walk up to somebody and say, you're the ugliest person I've ever seen in my life and that's your opinion, you're entitled to it. Are you going to pretend like it's not hateful? Are you going to hide behind the fact that it's your opinion?
But sometimes people also just want to be acknowledged too. I mean, when you asked for fallout, there wasn't much fallout. She did because I shared it. And actually, I didn't make the mistake in the first minute because what I, you know, for the lesson learned that I learned there, when you put it to your profile, there's a link to their profile. After a minute, someone let me know, said, hey, just so you know, you can, cause like it was obvious that I was trying to not show her identity cause I covered the face. And so I deleted it, screenshot that. So then there was no link and then put it back up all covered. But, so just so you know. But anyways, at that point now she saw that I saw that and she wrote back something like, oh my God, I love you. Just kidding. Ha ha ha. Which is kind of like,
how it always is.
It's always that. We're just like, probably not. But now that you feel bad and whatever. But again, you just kind of want to be acknowledged.
Yeah.
Eating disorders.
Segways.
Segway. I mean, I don't have a lot of experience with that. I know my sister, I don't know if she's had Maria, who's now a holistic nutritionist, when she was younger. I don't know if she actually had an eating disorder, but she, to her own admission, had unhealthy eating habits. Mm-hmm. And I'm sure there's various degrees. Is that something you still struggle with in terms of eating disorders?
Wouldn't say so. Okay. I think it's one of those things that if you're feeling bad about yourself, it might creep up and then there might be some disordered eating. But I was at a place where I was like, I was having trouble forcing myself to swallow food. Like I would try to eat and like spit it back out.
So was that,
and I would do that like
that extreme.
Yeah. So it was pretty bad, but like I was also not losing weight at all because like, I don't know the fucking science of it, but like if you put something in your mouth and your insulin spikes and then you're have all this extra insulin. I don't fucking know. But basically I was like eating things and spitting it out, but then my body wasn't getting the nutrition it needed. So I'm like holding more weight to my body.
You were chewing. Starvation.
You're putting it in your mouth. There was a guy on a bachelor season and I won't say who, but he would eat bread. He would chew bread and spit it out.
Mm-hmm. It's a form of bulimia because bulimia is just binging and purging. So I would like,
but he wouldn't swallow.
Binge,
he would like
it.
Chew it and then spit
it's
it out.
A form of
yeah.
Yeah. Because your purging doesn't have to be throwing up. Purging can be like you eat a bunch and then you're like purging by running on the treadmill for 5 hours straight every day. Or it could be you're binging by putting it in your mouth and chewing it up and then spitting it back out. So that was kind of my form of it where it like literally like fucked up my teeth, fucked up my body, fucked up my metabolism.
How long did you struggle with that?
Probably like right after college, during college, so like 2013 until like last year.
Oh my God.
Well, I mean, good for you for finally being able to. What are some takeaways for the people who are listening who could be struggling with that right now to like help them identify for themselves that maybe they need some help?
First of all, just know that whatever you're doing, whatever eating disorder that you have is not helping you be healthy or lose weight. Like I struggled with it for so long because I was really holding weight because my body was in starvation mode and because I wasn't getting the proper nutrition I needed. And when I started eating more, I like doubled my calories a day. I started shredding weight.
Interesting. Yeah, well, yes, that's your body. If when you eat, it reminds your metabolism, it needs to work. And when you starve yourself, it tells your metabolism, well, I guess we can take a vacation and it affects your body. When you had the eating disorder, were you aware that you had a problem and didn't care thinking it was going to help and then you're realizing it didn't? You know, does that make sense?
No, you could not tell me that I had a problem.
You didn't think, okay.
Yeah,
so you
like
weren't
my
aware.
Therapist tried to tell me where he recommended an eating disorder specialist. I was like, I don't have an eating disorder. And then he was trying to like, because therapists, their job isn't really to be like, this is your problem, how to fix it. They try to steer you in the direction. So he was trying to steer me in that way. And I was just like, no, you're wrong. Like what I'm doing is working. And he was like, well, is it? Because you're here.
Well, there were, so I guess to that point, were there things looking back now, kind of being in the denial that you could say, you know what, that was a red flag to myself. That was another red flag. What made you kind of admit it to yourself?
I think the thing to look out for is your weight and eating something that is consuming a very large portion of your headspace.
Like you're putting a lot of energy into what you were eating and how you were looking.
Yeah.
Okay.
I had a very unhealthy relationship with diet, food, and body image in general. And my goal was to be skinny and look good. And then once I shifted my brain and my mindset to, okay, I need to be healthy first. And then once you're healthy, everything will come as a byproduct. That was the thing that I just needed that mental switch of, I am so unhealthy right now. I am so unhappy. My skin is breaking out. I have no energy. I hate the way I feel and I hate the way I look. So let's start from the inside and work out.
Well, and then when you got to that realization, what was the kind of the first steps in terms of getting the help that you needed?
I am fortunate enough that I was in a position where I challenged myself to put out a project, like an 8-week video project where I said, I'm going to do a full body transformation. I'm going to see what I can do in 8 weeks. And I found a trainer to help. But I know a lot of people aren't in the position where they can do that. Mm-hmm. But what I learned from it is I had these expectations for myself where if I didn't see results in like 8 weeks, that there was an issue. So it started with like, I want to do a month transformation. And he said, let's try 8 weeks. And then we did 8 weeks. And he was like, I really think you should give us at least 12. And then after 12 weeks, I was like, let's keep going. And it ended up being a year long project in a video where I showed a year's transformation of ups and downs and weight gains and weight loss and like breakdowns and feeling like it's time to give up and injuries. And then finally, a year later, my body was in a place where it was its own entity and I didn't have to keep working at it. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. And now it's like 3 years in and my body's at a place where like I had a knee injury and I couldn't work out for a month. And I was kind of struggling with the fact that I couldn't work out and I could see the weight gain and I'm still trying to like get my body back where it was, but I'm not having panic attacks about it. I'm not like in my head, I know that it'll be okay. And I don't put so much self-worth on the way my ass looks anymore, but like, give me another month and it'll look great.
Like, it won't ruin my life. I mean, I think I might follow you on Instagram, but I've certainly looked at your Instagram, but you talk a lot about body positivity and you mm-hmm. kind of put your body out there on your Instagram, but not in a necessarily seductive way, but in a empowering sort of way. Is that something, you know, that's something I notice. Is that mm-hmm. deliberate that you do in terms of yeah. helping? Do you do it for yourself? Do you do it for your fans? Do you do it for both?
Both. I would say that it's just, I like to do it because I'm so proud of what I've done with my body. And I've kind of known it within the like 6 years that I've been on the internet, like I've been called like fat for the first three, you know what I mean? And people judging my body and saying I'm disgusting and sloppy. And like, so I'm proud of what I've done, but I know that there's a lot of people out there who have watched me since then, who've watched me transform. And like, those are the stories that excite me the most when somebody comes up to my meet and greet and they say like, I've just lost 70 pounds and I did it because I started following what you were doing. So that stuff is for them as much as it's for me.
Yeah. We all have our insecurities, and obviously putting your life out there on the internet gives people an opportunity to poke at some of our insecurities or create new ones. What are some things that you've been insecure about that you feel like you've it's developed into a strength, or what are some things that like you didn't even realize you were insecure about and all of a sudden you're like, fuck, you know? Wait, thanks for letting me know.
Yeah, there's a lot of that. I had this mole on my forehead.
Okay.
That one time somebody commented and they said something, they called it like a piece of meat on my face. And those words stuck with me and I got it removed.
Very descriptive. No.
Very descriptive. Like the word a piece of meat, which is like, ugh! So I got it cut off. But I think a lot of the insecurity comes from like my work and like my music and singing, because I'm proud of my work. So when people say that like, I'm bad and I need to quit, that affects me a lot, especially like when I was a meme and everybody was saying I'm a joke and like my music is a joke, but that pushed me to write one of my best songs to date from that situation.
Do you feel like you're constantly trying to get more respect? I only ask that because I sometimes feel that way.
Yeah.
And you mentioned earlier about coming from the YouTube space of the preconceived notions that come with it and you're doing other things. Do you struggle with that?
I would say, yeah, because people will label you as like, oh, this like Viner, everybody thinks they can sing, everybody thinks blah, blah, blah. And I put out my poetry book before anything else. And a lot of people were reading it. And as I was reading the criticisms of it, it was because everybody was reading it very surface level. And if you would dissect it and give it the critical thought that you would give any other poet, you would find that like these aren't these surface level poems that you're making them out to be. Like there's this one about taking naps and sleep and everybody's like, this is so dumb. It's like a limerick about sleep and it's about suicide. But they didn't give it the benefit of the doubt that I'm capable of that type of critical thinking. So people didn't read it, I think, the way that they should have. Does that make sense?
Yeah, yeah. No, I get it. And do you, I ask these questions speaking from my own kind of inner thoughts, but have you been able to draw the line of like letting your fans who do understand that defend you, or going down that rabbit hole and be like, no, it's about this, and trying to convince every individual on their own of understanding where you're coming from.
And I've also noticed that hate is louder, but love is stronger. And the people I've noticed that are tweeting and commenting, those aren't people that were really there to support me in the first place. And like, my fans are generally a little bit older too, and they're not the type to like go on Twitter and be like, well, this is bullshit and you're wrong. So I call it, this is going to sound awful. No, I'm not going to say it because people will take it and run with it.
Oh my God, say it, no, please.
I think it's kind of like the Trump effect. And I'm not saying I support Trump, but it's like—
We're not a political show. We're not saying anything.
No, it's just the idea of everybody was so dumbfounded when Trump won because they were like, everybody hates Trump. Nobody supports Trump. He's not going to win.
There's a lot of people who like Trump.
That's what I'm saying. So when he won the election and he was like, the popular vote was not that far off, people were like, oh, shocked. But it was because the people who were supporting Hillary were just very loud and vocal on the internet. The people who supported Trump didn't want to speak online because they were afraid of the scrutiny that they would face.
There was definitely that phenomenon.
Yeah. So I think that there's a lot of silent supporters of my music and book, and the numbers show that. They're just not on the internet being like—
Well, yeah, but you're suggesting that people are afraid to support you, and I don't think that's
true. No, they are.
Oh,
you think they're afraid?
No,
you have a lot of outspoken. I mean, I don't know much about you other than the fact that you have a very dedicated, strong fan base.
I do, but during some of these like scandals, I saw a lot of my own fans tweeting. A lot of them are tweeting like, hey guys, like, I don't know if I should stan Gabbie anymore, and like saying basically that they were getting hate for supporting me. So just for the sole fact that these people were fans of mine and had my face set as their profile picture and tried to defend me and still supported me, they were getting loads of hate, and then they deleted their accounts because they were getting so much hate just by proxy. So like,
sure. They weren't as outspoken during whatever scandal.
That's cancel culture. Yeah, like they were too scared to support. So now, like, yeah, they're still going to download my music, but are they going to be on Twitter talking about it? No, because they're scared.
Well, I mean, hate is always going to be louder than the positivity.
Yeah,
I mean, people don't have much time to say I love you, but they'll let you know if they have a problem.
Exactly.
This is kind of how.
You're quicker to leave a negative Yelp review than a positive one.
Yeah.
Nobody goes up to the manager and talks about what great service they had.
Right.
That is true. They're far more motivated to let them know.
Complain.
Of their bad time.
Yeah.
You are recently in a new relationship. Is that true?
Yes. I've never been public before.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
I read something when I was doing my research that you went through a period of time of not putting it out there and being very discreet, which I thought was interesting, not knowing much about you, for someone who shares so much about her life. What made you choose to slow play that kind of reveal of the person you were in a relationship with?
Well, this person, I haven't even really been with that long. It's only been a few months. I've been with people for like a year who nobody's ever seen.
Okay.
Because this is kind of what I was saying earlier about, like, you don't know my whole life. I share for entertainment purposes what I think is important or like what I want to share. But like something like my relationships, my friendships, I keep on the low because I like to know that people are in my life for a real reason and that they're not here just for like numbers or like because it's interesting. That's one reason I like to keep it private. But also, I've never been really confident that somebody that I was with was the real deal or like somebody I wanted to share. And I never wanted to be in a situation where I would have to go through like this big public breakup and wanted my relationship and breakup up for public debate. So
are you public with this person now?
Yeah. I've never posted publicly about somebody and I was just like, fuck it.
How long have you been dating?
A few months.
Excited?
Yeah.
What's the thing you love most about this relationship? Why you feel so safe with it?
It's just one of those cliches that you don't think is real until you find it, where it's just like, oh, this is what it's supposed to be. This is what love is.
What's different about this one than past ones? Other than a gut feeling.
Besides a gut feeling, yeah. He's just somebody who it's easy. He's dependable. He clearly wants to make me happy and I want to make him happy. So it's this very symbiotic relationship of doing whatever we can to make each other happy. And in making each other happy, we make ourselves happy.
What do you think what's most different about you in your, I mean, what I'm saying is in your actions towards mm-hmm. him than you were in other relationships?
I'm a person who is a direct reciprocator of what I'm receiving. So with him, I receive a lot of thought and attention and love. So I'm giving a lot of thought and attention and love, where from the jump, right out of the gate in relationships, I'm somebody who throws in my all and I want to give you my time. I want to give you my effort and my attention. And I haven't always gotten that back. And this is somebody who from the jump wanted to give that back. And I was in a place where I didn't want a relationship at all. I wasn't looking. I just got out of like a very toxic relationship that I needed a lot of space to heal from. So I got on a dating app and I basically needed validation and attention and kind of stumbled upon this person. And he was very persistent and dedicated and showed me that he was in it for the right reasons. And he didn't want any, I didn't even kiss him for 11 dates. And he
11 dates,
11,
no kiss.
And that's why I was like, damn, this guy is in it, because he didn't care about anything except getting to know
me. And you appreciated persistence.
I appreciated it because I could tell that like, he was just so interested in getting to know me. Like when he asked me on our third date, he asked me to go see a movie and I tried to end it because I was like, it's a third date. That's kind of like the first kiss date. And he wants to go to a movie. That's like a very intimate setting. So I said to him,
wait, a movie's an intimate setting?
It's like in the dark and you're sitting close together and like, he's going to try to put his arm around me and he might try to kiss me. And it just wasn't what I wanted.
I don't know. I disagree.
Really?
I think in eighth grade, it was the intimate setting. But to me, a movie is a very... an adult date, I think a movie is kind of a throwaway date. And I don't mean that in
really?
A negative way. I mean like, all right, I enjoy hanging out with this person. I don't feel the pressure to have to like have more conversation, get to know them. I just kind of want to be around them, but I don't need to like try to make a move. So let's
but
just go to a public place.
But even the physical proximity of it though, like.
What's the most you can do and be comfortable, hold hands?
I didn't even want him to put his arm around me at this point.
Okay.
Like that's how, like this, the relationship that I just got out of like fucked me up. Like okay. I didn't want to be touched. I didn't want to be like close. I didn't want to be intimate with anybody. So like even the thought of him trying to hold my hand because we're sitting next to
nervous.
Each other.
Okay.
I just wasn't.
Okay.
I mean, in a place.
Yes. I mean, you have to be open to a handhold and a movie.
That's what I'm saying. So I straight up told him like, hey, so like, I'm not really in a place to like be there, whatever. And he said, that's okay. We can go for a hike. And I was like,
you like the hike?
Yeah. So we went for a hike.
Hike.
But it's less, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah. I've been on a hike, not touched a guy.
Yeah. Like you're like chugging up the hill.
Yeah.
You know, I get it. But I find this interesting more because of the slow play of it.
Yeah.
I mean, there must have been a lot of communication going on throughout these 11 dates that made him not feel discouraged. Do you guys talk about this now that you're in a relationship of like what his mindset was going on during these 11 days? Mm-hmm. Because it can, from a guy's point of view, get kind of confusing of like, I don't think she's that into me, but she keeps hanging out, but we're going on 11 dates. So like, am I friend zone? Like what's going on? We're hiking
now?
He
kind of was for a second. In my mind, he was a little bit friend-zoned, but I was always very open with him where I was, and he was always very open with me about how he felt about it. So I would tell him, like, I straight up apologized after, I think, six dates. I was like, I'm really sorry. Like, it's not, like, I'm trying. I'm just not there yet. And he told me later, he's like, as long as you were showing me that there was some type of interest, I was willing to put in as much time as
it took. Well, acknowledging that you're like, you understand where he might be coming from, and that that's very... To me, that would tell me I'm not necessarily in the friend zone. I'm in this kind of gray area. I'm in this early relationship it sounds like a mature one where there's a lot of communication going on and not this kind of pressure of living up to these expectations of like, well, it's our third date. We need to have sex or we need to at least make out or something like
and
that.
And I think that's also why our relationship is so different and strong is I've never felt so openly free to communicate how I was feeling with somebody before. And I've never had somebody communicate with me so openly about how he was feeling before. And I think he's told me like, he's like, the person you know isn't who I've ever been in a relationship. Like, this is completely new for me.
You said this.
He said this to me. He was like, this isn't who I normally am. Like, you get a new side of me that I didn't know existed.
Like, well, what did that mean? Did that make you go, well, what were you like?
No, just like we're very affectionate.
Okay.
He's very communicative. Like, we spend a lot of time together and he's in past said, like, I've never been the person to be this affectionate. I've never wanted to spend this much time. He's like, I would literally put a pillow in between me and the person I was sleeping with because I didn't want to be affectionate with them. But with us, it's just like constant, like, touching each other at all times, you know?
That's interesting. And I find the persistent part interesting because I think sometimes persistence nowadays gets a bad rap.
Yeah.
it's a subtlety though, right? Yeah. Like, you know, you could be a persistent guy and you need to be like, you need to stop calling her, dude, because she's asking you to.
Well,
you know,
he gave me space too, okay, though. And I think that was what was so special is like after our first date, he waited almost a week before trying again because he knew I wasn't in a place.
And it sounds like while you slow played it, you never closed all the doors and windows, so to speak. It was just very slow, but you always were receptive to him reaching back out.
Like I never didn't answer his text.
He just didn't give up.
He didn't give up, yeah.
Or he didn't make you a bad person for, because sometimes I've had guys get angry.
Yeah, for sure.
And you're like, I'm busy, I'm sorry.
I think that's a huge criticism of guys is that they are confused about a woman's intentions, their interest in them, and instead of asking questions and empathizing where they're coming from, they try to fill in their own gaps, get defensive, get accusatory. Is that a word?
Yeah.
Get aggressive, and then there's a lack of communication. So it sounds like, how old is he?
30. Okay. He's just a good guy. And it was like, it was at the right time. Like we found each other, right time, right place. It was kind of kismet and I'm cool with
it. Well, congratulations. I wish you guys the best of luck.
Thank you.
It's nice to have someone, you know, around. it's great. Before I let you go, we like to play a little game with our guest called Do You Know Me?
Fun.
It's real simple.
Okay.
Rochelle and I are going to guess who knows Gabbie better.
Okay.
They're real simple questions.
Out of you two?
Yeah. Which, I mean, the people listening can certainly, I wonder if people listening play along.
Of course they do.
They must.
Tell them to leave a 5-star review and leave their answers with it.
Oh my God,
please. Don't answer the question aloud.
Okay. Okay.
We'll guess and then let us know if we guessed correct. You'll catch on real quick.
Okay.
This will be fun because I don't know Gabbie much more than our conversation. No.
Yeah.
So
I kind of pick some random questions.
Rochelle picks these questions out.
Okay.
Question number one. Did Gabbie fail their driving test the first time?
What a funny random question.
I know, they're all going to be like this.
Yes.
I know, I kind of think yes too, is that mean?
No, I did.
You failed it?
Yeah.
Really?
I failed it because it was at a four-way stop.
Yeah.
And, that's not true. I thought I was at a four-way stop. And the other direction had a yield sign. And so they were like coming and I started going. And, But my second time I took it, 0 points off.
Did you have your own car?
No, my parents' car.
Nice. I failed twice.
Twice?
Yeah, I was very determined to not fail the third time because the third time you have to retake your permit and I just wasn't confident that I could pass.
Right.
Why'd you fail?
The first time I failed immediately trying to parallel park and then because they make you do that first. And then the second time I failed because I did the whole test, but then on the way back, I was going down the wrong side of the road. So I was going against traffic.
That'll do it.
Yeah.
That'll
do it.
I'm an excellent parallel parker.
Really? Are you? I am
great.
Now.
I'm really good.
Do you have a backup camera?
Yeah, backup camera is key.
I don't need one, but yes, I do.
How do people do it without it?
I don't know.
It doesn't make sense.
Real simple.
No.
I don't know if I could describe this over a podcast, but most cars have like their light in the middle. It's all about finding that middle section of your rear view window.
What?
Yeah, there's a light, right? Right in the middle of your, when you turn on the back, right? And that middle, you line that up with the far right corner of the car, the corner of the front car that's closest to the curb. And when you turn that middle car, you line up and at the last minute you flip it.
I didn't follow.
Me neither.
But that's just what you do. I know it's hard to describe. I'd have to draw it out.
I have no spatial reasoning. Like
me
I don't
either.
I
me
can't
either.
Figure out how long the front of my car is and if I'm gonna hit something.
Yeah. I'm just remembering I had the creepiest. I had like my dad bought like driver's training with I drove with this guy around.
Okay, yeah.
And he was so creepy, 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 creepy.
I never did. Fired. I only, hey, in my defense also, I only had 2 weeks of practice driving before I took my test because I got my permit when I was 18 years old, drove for 2 weeks because when you're 18, you only have to do it for 2 weeks, not 6 months. Okay. Drove for 2 weeks and took my test. So I didn't do that bad.
It's fine. A lot of people do fail, I think, the first time.
I think so too. Because nerves.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Question number two. Does Gabbie have more unread text messages than the person to their left? Okay.
You're to my left.
I have. Currently.
Don't say.
Okay.
Nick. Don't say because I'm going to guess first. I'm going to say Nick has more because he doesn't.
I currently have a lot.
How many?
Right now?
Yeah.
That have been texted while we...
But you got to guess if Gabbie has more or less than you.
She has less than me.
I said less too. Yeah. Okay.
How many do you have? It should just say the number, shouldn't it?
Yeah, look at the number.
Look at the number.
Well, I have from multiple people.
No, but what's the number on your home screen?
Oh, I've...
Look at your...
Oh, see, I opened it up. Oh, 19.
I have exactly 19.
Oh my God! Twins. I have 53.
Oh my God.
I don't know.
You have 53 unread texts?
That was like for real, like came out of nowhere with that one.
I guess I'm okay, afraid underdog. To look at texts.
They give me anxiety. I'm like,
you definitely do.
I get afraid of things.
She really does. Wild.
We all need therapy.
I've been working with Rochelle for a whole year now, and I'm just getting to the tip of the iceberg of understanding her. It's been a wild ride. Oh, no. Question number three. Does Abby sleep with stuffed animals? Yes.
Yes.
Do I?
Wait, I'm changing to no. I'm changing to no. Yeah. Can I do that?
No, okay. I have none.
Yes!
Yeah.
You cheated there.
Why did you think?
You seem like an affectionate person. Yeah. I don't know. Like
the comfort of a soft flesh.
I'm either as cold as stone or the most affectionate person you've ever met, and I'm nothing in between.
Oh. What do you sleep with? Just one bare sheet? Oh, damn you.
Oh, that was a flex. That was confident in the relationship. How quickly we forget that we were single.
But what would you sleep with?
Listen, I've been chronically single for 28 years. This is the first time I'm like, I have a boyfriend.
All right, next question. Does Abby own...
Are you calling me Abby?
Oh, Abby, God.
It's okay.
Abby. We're going to edit that out because I don't know your fans are going to be super...
You did it on the last one too.
Oh, no.
Did I?
Oh, I didn't notice.
Yeah, I let it slip because I was like, maybe
I... Did I in the last one?
Yeah.
Oh.
It's okay.
I'm going to read that question again and then we'll edit...
No,
does Gabbie sleep with stuffed animals? All right. Damn, what a dick.
No, you're okay.
Why did I say Abby?
Because it's a more common name. It's okay.
No, but sometimes I do it where like there's a reason I can know why, you know, where like it's, you know.
It's okay.
Quick.
It's just a name.
Forgive yourself.
I thought your last name was Viall until somebody told me it was Viall yesterday.
Viall.
So. Viall. Okay. See? I'm a dick.
No.
I've never seen The Bachelor. I'm a dick.
It's not the same. It's not the same. Thank you. Does Gabbie own a fanny pack?
I picked that one? I don't remember picking that one.
Well,
oh, you just... Oh.
No, it's right.
A fanny pack. Yes.
Yes.
Fanny packs are
even. I think you're fashion forward. I would even go as far as saying she had a fanny pack right before it got really trendy.
Yeah.
I had a fanny pack before it was cool. However, I've never worn one for fashion purposes. I wear them to hike, which is worse.
Hiking fannies.
Yeah, because great. I don't want to hold my phone while hiking.
Worse?
Because like I wear it in the loser way. I wear it in the way your aunt would wear it in 1998.
Practical.
Yeah.
I went to a football game a few weeks ago and I bought a fanny pack because
hell yeah.
Because I could, you know, I was going to be all day and I have like a Mophie portable charger.
They don't let you bring fanny packs in.
I mean, I guess I...
They let you?
Me.
Oh.
Well,
that's not true. Like, I mean, they had to open it up, but like, oh. I had a portable charger.
Yeah, because you have purses.
In a football game?
Yeah.
Oh, I brought a fanny. They were like, never do this again.
Really?
Really?
I don't know.
That's weird.
Huh.
It's very weird.
Yeah, it looks suspicious.
Yeah, you look really...
You are very intimidating.
Has Gabbie ever... missed a flight?
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah.
I've only ever missed a flight when my first flight didn't land in time.
Oh, that
and
doesn't
it was
count.
In fucking Turkey. It happened there and back. I was going to Greece, and both there and back, there's only one flight to Athens. And if you don't catch it, you're fucked. And I had to stay overnight in like a very scary location two times.
Oh, no.
Yeah. But I don't think I've ever missed a flight on my own accord.
Oh.
I'm very paranoid about missing flights.
Good for you. I wait till the last minute to get the airport.
I missed one once, not too recently ago, maybe like a year. 2 years ago, but it was like it was an early flight, like a 7 a.m. flight, 6:30 flight. So I had to wake up really early. My alarm didn't go off, and I woke up maybe like an hour before my flight. So
and there's
like,
no way you're making it.
I was like, no, but I gave it the
you
old college
it.
Try.
You gave it your best because sometimes they're
and
late.
I call an Uber, and you know, it's early, so there's no traffic.
It, yeah.
Right there. And I made it. Like, here's what's annoying.
It
usually
so
I don't check a bag, but for whatever reason I had a big suitcase, so I checked a bag, and I got there too late for them to check the bag, so they refused to check it, and they fucking could have. And then I got like through security with like five minutes before the gate even closed, so I got like I made it in time, but like I couldn't go on that flight.
Why?
Because you
I had
the bag.
They wouldn't check the bag.
You took the bag with you through security?
No, I had a big suitcase.
Yeah.
I had to check it. It wasn't like I had an option to check it or not check it.
But you still went through security.
Yeah. How'd you get through security?
Oh, because they put me on the next flight. So I had to sit there and wait 3 hours.
Oh.
And so I annoying. Went through security only to like walk up to the flight that I was supposed to be on while people were boarding the flight.
Oh, that's
so annoying.
It was so, I was so fucking annoyed.
That's really annoying.
That actually happened to me one time, but they did check my bag because you're supposed, I think it's 20 minutes before boarding. You have to check your bag. And I was just like in tears. I was like, please.
Yeah, no, I should have gave a better performance because it was definitely one of those moments. And it's
they're
a
like,
pet,
this asshole,
it's
no.
a pet peeve of mine where like anyone in kind of a customer service job and they'll say, well, sorry, we can't, it's nothing we can do. And I know you've said this before, because this is not the way to get your way, by the way.
Yeah, I can already tell what you're about to say.
And I'm like,
not a good call.
It's not that you can't. It's just that you won't.
Uh-oh.
Did you say it?
Yeah. At that point, I knew they weren't going to do it. But like,
the only thing worse he could have said is, have you seen The Bachelor?
I've never done that. But yes, but you just got to beg for people's help. Please help me.
What is it? Is it Meet the Fockers where he's getting on the plane with the woman and the chopsticks in
her? Ba-bam, ba-bam, ba-bam.
People love to feel like they're helping.
Yeah. You just got to make people feel like they can literally save your life.
Yeah. And like, honestly, it would have helped you a lot.
I tried that move. And then I knew she wasn't going to help me.
You're just like, fuck you.
And I was just like, please stop telling me you can't help me.
Yeah.
Because you can. You just don't want to.
Yeah.
I was really pissed. Anyways, last question. Has Gabbie ever had a pet guinea pig?
Very specific.
That is very specific.
I'm going to say yes. I can imagine her with one. A nice little guinea pig.
I'm going to say no.
My brother's...
We had one as kids.
Engaged to a girl who has guinea pigs.
I thought you were going to say engaged to a guinea pig.
Yeah.
She had a woman with guinea pigs.
How many?
He has to wait to come to Christmas late because he has to take care of the guinea pigs.
Okay, that's weird.
Whoa.
Who is this?
My brother's fiance. He got engaged.
You jelly?
No.
Do they listen to this? Because...
No.
No
one I know listens to this podcast.
An adult with multiple guinea pigs.
Yeah. My sister-in-law.
I've never had one. I do think guinea pigs are more of a child pet because they're so easy to care for, but I think that there's adults with them.
There are.
I mean, there are. Your brother's fiance has guinea pigs.
What pets do you have?
I don't have any pets, but I really want to get rats.
Oh.
Listen, no, stop. Right. Listen, rats get a bad rap and I'm tired of
they
it.
They might. That's fair.
They're
but
very small,
also
very
you.
Cute. They're very cute. And they're just like dogs. They come when you call them. They do tricks. They sit. They stay. They just love to be cuddled. They're generally pretty clean. Like, they're actually very cute and cuddly.
If they're hungry enough, they'll eat you.
No, they won't. Okay, for sure they would. But also, so would your dog. Like, if you left a canine and, like, it's hungry enough, it's going to fucking start biting.
Yeah.
And also just feed your fucking rats.
Okay, fine.
They don't eat that much.
You're probably right. I'm just not...
Have you ever seen a video of like a rat being cute as hell?
No.
Google it.
I find them to be really not attractive.
But you're probably thinking of like a lab rat or like a street rat.
No, it's just their tail doesn't do it lab for me.
Rat. Okay, their street tails, rat. You got to get past the tail.
I don't really have to, but yeah, I do support you supporting the rat community. They probably could use some friends. No, that's fine. Yeah.
The rat community. Oh,
an advocate for rats.
A rat commit.
The title of this episode.
Rat commit.
Well, Gabbie, I really appreciate you coming on. It's been a lot of fun. Where can people find you?
If you search Gabbie Hanna on iTunes or YouTube or anywhere really, you can find me there.
And your new podcast? Give it a little plug. Tell us a little bit about what it's about.
Box of Thoughts. It's where I just unpack my thoughts for the week. It's basically just a conversation with my best friend every week.
If someone's a giant YouTube fan of yours and also interested in podcasts, what's different about your YouTube versus your podcast?
Podcast is completely uncut, unfiltered. It's talking about, you know, real stuff. It's not focused around an activity that I'm doing. That's pretty much it. It's just a more uncut, unfiltered, uncensored version.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Cool. Well, check it out, everyone. Thanks for listening, Gabbie. Again, thanks for coming.
Thank you for having me.
Yeah, guys, 5 stars, as Gabbie mentioned. We love 5 stars. We would appreciate if you give us one, right?
No, give me 5.
5 star. Yeah. 1 5-star. Or can you give more than 1?
Probably not. Unless they're real dedicated and they make multiple accounts. But I heard you're a douchebag in person, according to the one girl on Instagram. So.
Oh, that one. Yeah.
Yeah. He's not, by the way. He's actually a very nice person. I talked to you off camera. You're nice.
Thank you. Thanks for listening, guys. Have a great day.